watching Pulse on Mirror Now. I'm Amita Balachandra. Today we get you a shocking story that's coming to light from the city of Mumbai. Over 87 people have been duped due to fraudulent transactions via ATM machines. We're going to be talking about the use of skimmers in ATM machines and how it could impact you, because today it was these 87 people, tomorrow it could be anybody else. We're going to be talking about what you and I can do to safeguard our money. That's coming up later on the show. Delhi High Court summons Virendra Dev Dixit, founder of Adhyatmik Vishwavidyalaya, orders inspection of 8 other ashrams run by the self-proclaimed Godman after raids revealed how 100 girls, including minors, were confined and tortured in the Rohini ashram. Also coming up, 10 days since the death of MC Arpita Tiwari, no arrest made so far. Family approaches Chief Minister's office seeking the arrest of Arpita's friends who were present on the spot on that fateful night. Our top focus this evening, a very shocking story coming to light from the city of Mumbai, where over 87 people have been duped. This is because of skimmers launched in these ATM machines. What can you and I do to safeguard our money in the banks? That's the question we're asking. Can we do anything at all? We have Vijay Mukhi, cyber expert, joining us on the show. But first, let's take the question across to Richa Sharma, who's joining us with some of those victims. Richa, over 87 people there, of course, duped. If you can take us through what exactly happened.
That's right, Amita. On 7th and 8th of December and the first week of December, between 4th to 8th of December, a number of people had gone to this particular private bank ATM in the Mulund area to withdraw money as usual, like we all do. And they must have not anticipated that this time somebody have been watching or hacking their data and even the ATM pins that they were putting in. And about 87 people have been duped for about 27 lakh rupees. And most of these victims have stated that the message that they received on their phone was from ATMs of Delhi Saket area and Ghaziabad area. And they are stating that these withdrawals happened within seconds of each other, and these withdrawals basically happened in parts and not on one go. And I have with me a few of the victims here as well who have suffered on account of this. Let's start with one of the ladies here who have suffered the most. She has actually suffered a loss of about 1,60,000 rupees on that particular day. And let's know what exactly happened. So ma'am, you have suffered the most amount of loss when it comes to this ATM fraud. What exactly happened that day?
I just started getting messages around 11:20 that, you know, my debit card, there are withdrawals. So I was a little surprised because I was in position with the card. And the speed of the transaction was what surprised me. And I couldn't reach customer care, and so I reached the bank manager and he asked me to block the card over internet banking. And that was hardly 10 minutes totally, the entire process. And within that, these transactions happened. So the speed of the transaction is what surprises, actually.
And did you notice anything unusual that day when you had gone to withdraw the money like usually you do? Did you anticipate any of this happening?
Nothing like that. I mean, that is an ATM I've been using quite frequently. So nothing that I can really think back or look or find misplaced than normal. So,
Even you have lost about 40,000 rupees. You tell us what exactly happened with her that day, and what have you received your money back?
No, we haven't received the money back, but the branch manager is saying it takes around 21 days to settle a dispute. What exactly happened is around 11:45 at midnight, we got SMSs on the wife's cell, and by the time she came to me saying that, okay, this is I'm getting some transactions on my debit card. It was just a matter of 1 minute or something. And by the time I could call and block the card, I had 4 transactions within span of 2 minutes.
Okay.
And by the 5th transaction was about to go through, I got a call SMS from the Standard Chartered Fraud Department saying that, are you doing transactions or not? So by the time the 5th transaction got declined, the card was blocked.
Okay.
Actually, what I feel is they had targeted at that particular time, you know, because after 12, the limit gets reset.
Right.
So most of the people who have been a victim of this are between the, you know, the time when the limit gets reset.
Right.
And what was surprising is she doesn't get that SMS. The pattern of the SMS, which usually comes from Standard Chartered, the SMS which she received is of a different format.
Right.
So from, you know, usually in Standard Chartered we get the SMS like what location the ATM is.
Right.
So first four withdrawals didn't have any location.
Right.
And the fifth withdrawal had a socket location which was even misspelled. It was not a correct spelling of that location.
So sir, how unsafe do you think after you have experienced this again, you have been victimized in the situation, how unsafe now you feel when you are withdrawing a cash amount from an ATM as well?
See, from the day when I have lost this money, you know, I have not gone to any of the ATMs.
Hmm.
I think it's better, you know, I will take a token from the bank and I will wait for in a queue to get my money.
Right. That's the thing,
you know. Like.
So clearly, Amita, these victims here have been traumatized as well as a bit more cautious now since the incident has come to light. And as you just heard, that this is not a work of a rookie. This is a specialized thing that what did happen to them on this particular day. And most of these incidents occurred of these withdrawals on 17th of this month, which now the police is certainly looking into investigating. A team has already reached Delhi. But certainly, this has created an amount of fear in the minds of people who go out there to withdraw money every single day, like we all do. So certainly it seems like people have to take much more precaution when it comes to withdrawing money from ATMs as well now.
All right, Richard, do stay with us. We'll try and come back to you in just a bit. We have Vijay Mukhi joining us at this point in time. You know, we heard a couple of victims there, extremely scary. The way they said that within a matter of minutes, there were one, two, three, four transactions before they could even block their card. Take us through how this exactly is done.
Well, it's very simple. It requires very low technology, so I'm overqualified for this. Today, there's really no difference between an ATM card, a debit card, and a credit card. Now, this, what I'm holding in my hand, is a credit card, which actually got cloned. Now, my name is there, my credit card number is there, my expiry date is there, but none of this information is important. What is important is this magnetic stripe at the back of the card. So when somebody swipes my credit card, this contains my data, my credit card number. Now, it costs 3,000 rupees to buy a machine that can read this magnetic stripe and make a copy of it. So all that somebody does when you say you're cloning a credit card or an ATM card is you are simply copying the magnetic stripe. That's it. You're not doing anything else. Now, because it was so easy, they added a big jump in protection, and that is there's a chip on this card. Now, this chip, as of today, nobody's been able to break it. So you can't copy this chip at all. So that's why when you use a chip-based credit card, you actually put it like this in the machine. You don't swipe the card. So my data is now on this chip. You can't copy this credit card at all. So this is, in that sense, unclonable, whatever you want. Now the problem is that this is a debit card. This is an ATM card. This has a magnetic stripe, but this has no chip on it. So because there's no chip, it takes 3,000 rupees to make a copy of this card. That's it.
And what about the ATM pin?
Now what happens is, as an added measure of security, your pin is not on this debit card. The pin is always in your mind. It's stored separately. So what people do is, on an ATM machine, they need to do two things. They install a skimmer, which is to copy the magnetic stripe. Then on the keypad, they add another keypad. So all that second keypad does is it copies your PIN number, which means that now the hacker who's hacked into your ATM machine has done two things. He's added an extra keyboard, he's added something to copy the magnetic card. Now what he does is he's far away from the machine. The skimming machine then sends the same data to him through either SMS or Wi-Fi or Bluetooth or whatever it is. Now he has these two sets of data. As I said, the outer appearance of the card is not important. This is all that he needs to create a fake debit card, ATM card. So within minutes, he will enter the same ATM machine, the same city, or he may go to another city. And what does he do there? He knows how much money you have and he withdraws all the money in your account.
If it's so easy to sort of clone your cards, and we've seen the number of cases actually increase in the last couple of months, more being reported, why aren't the banks then using cards which...
Okay, now you see, to replace credit card machines, it's very cheap. You can have chip-based credit card machines, but our ATMs here are dinosaurs. They're very, very old. So you can't put a chip reading machine in them. You have to replace the entire thing. Now that would cost lakhs. So for the banks today, it's a simple economic decision. In Europe, the government said everybody has to go for a chip-based ATM machine. In America, you yet have these old dinosaurs working. So if the government of India tomorrow says that, Mr. Bank, you have to have a chip-based card, then everybody else, all ATMs will have to be replaced with a chip reading machine, which is a very big cost. That's why the banks are not doing it. So the technology is there. Europe is using it today. India is not, because even now we're looking at lakhs, but there it would be tens of thousands of crores which have to be spent.
Fair enough. Do hold that thought. We're going to come back and talk about how we can safeguard, and if we can actually safeguard our money at all. But let me go back to Richa at this point in time. Richa, what are banks here saying, the two private banks that we're talking about, what are they saying? Have these people who have been duped, have they gone back to their banks, spoken to them?
Amita, let me tell you, the fraud that happened was for one single bank ATM, one single private bank which had two ATMs, and these were the two ATMs that were targeted of a single bank. But the people who had come to withdraw these amount were from 20 different banks. So certainly this particular one private bank whose ATM has been triggered and who has been looted off from their money, they have certainly promised the people to return back the money, and many of them have even received it back. But when it comes to the other 20 customers of different banks who had come to withdraw money on that particular day, they are still waiting for that to come back, because there is a process through which they have to go. Let's talk to them as well and know what kind of a response they have received from their bank. So ma'am, the particular bank where you had gone to withdraw was the same account where you have your account. So did they reverse it back immediately, and what kind of a response did you receive?
No, I called the manager, and then I was immediately back to back. The senior from the branch was also put on a conference, and then also my fraud was recorded with the customer care. And even by the time I went to the police station to lodge a complaint that night, immediately the fraud department called me and they took a note of the details, and they said, we've already raised a fraud against your transaction. So the idea was, if it is fraud, it gets reversed to the customer. Okay. But the actual process hasn't happened, but they said because it's a fraud, it will get reversed to you.
What about you, sir? You are from the separate bank. You were not from the same one which as the ATM is. So what is the kind of response are you getting from your bank?
The bank said that it takes around 21 working days for the entire investigation to complete from the bank side, whether it's an actual authentic transaction or a fraud transaction. And post which they will... reverse the money to the account.
Okay, and so what about you? Was your process easier to get back your money?
See, no, because the same scenario, you know, like I have, they have told me to, like, you know, it will take some time because they need to get approvals from the higher authorities, and they have forwarded all the papers, whatever we have got from the police and all those things.
Okay. So, sir, do you think that the banks as well as the police is helpful enough to reverse in such a scenario? Because we are seeing a lot of these instances happening. So, how helpful do you think they are?
Police are very much helpful. वो लोगों ने बहुत मदद किया है. बैंक ने तो अभी मैंने HDFC का कार्ड स्वाइप किया था. तो कोटक में मैंने जाके पूछा तो कोटक वालों ने मेरे को बोला कि आपको पैसा रिटर्न मिलेगा. बट वो मिलने के लिए कुछ टाइम लगेगा. लेकिन पुलिस वाले बहुत हेल्पफुल है. उन्होंने बोला है कि आपको अगर पैसा रिटर्न नहीं मिल रहा है तो कम टू अस एंड वील सी टू इट कि आपको का पैसा रिटर्न मिले करके.
सो यू आर स्टिल वेटिंग फॉर द
अमाउंट? या या या.
सो अमिता, मोस्ट ऑफ दीज विक्टिम्स आर स्टिल वेटिंग फॉर द अमाउंट टू बी रिसीव्ड, ऑल्दो दिस पर्टिकुलर प्राइवेट बैंक हैज ऑलरेडी प्रोसेस्ड द मनी एंड process the credited amount which they have lost. But certainly it's a long process of at least 20 days to a month, which takes on an average in case of a person who loses money on account of fraudulent frauds or any kind of other skimming things that happen. So clearly it seems like they will have to wait a bit longer than expected to get back their own money, which now has been lost on account of this fraud here.
Well, absolutely hassled people indeed. Now, while people wait for the money to get back into their accounts, you tell us, in the ATM, ATMs that we see here, standalone or otherwise, there is generally a security personnel. You also have CCTV cameras. Despite that, this happens. So what can I do if I go into an ATM? What are the things that I should be looking for?
Well, the only reason why my ATM card has not been cloned so far is because I never use a standalone ATM machine ever in my life. For example, I would only use that ATM machine which is inside the premises of a bank. Because remember, here we're talking about a 24-hour ATM open. Now, the guard may want to answer nature's call, so he may go out for half an hour. That's the time the hacker uses to just add the cloning devices into the ATMs. So my suggestion is never use standalone ATM machines until they become chip-based. After that, beyond that, other than a prayer to God, you can do nothing else.
Okay. And despite that, even if I don't go, would it then be valid for me to say that I'm unsafe in the sense that if I go to a standalone ATM machine, I can't do anything about it?
Well, today, a so-called expert like me, if you show me an ATM machine with a skimming device and an ATM machine without a skimming device, I and the rest of the world will not recognize which is genuine, which is not. So if the security professional cannot detect by physical looks that this machine has a skimming device, how can an average person on the road? So there is no protection today at all, which is why the government should bring in rules.
So very quickly, we have just about 2 minutes left on this conversation. If you can tell us, what should the government do at this point in time to ensure that our money is safe?
Well, all that the government should do is two things. A, they need to do what Europe is doing. Make sure that the banks start slowly moving into chip-based ATM machines. The ATM machine should be able to read chips. The second thing is that if my bank account, my credit card, my debit card has been cloned, then the government should have a situation where I don't have to bear any loss. The bank automatically reverses the transactions. That's the short-term measure. The long-term measure is chip-based. I'm saying the technology is there. We need the will to implement the technology.
And while we wait for that to happen, thank you so much for joining us. But the biggest takeaway that's coming out of this conversation, of course, is that you must always ensure that you don't go to a standalone ATM like Vijay Mukhi was just pointing out. With that, let's move on to some breaking news that is coming in at this point in time. We understand that the BJP has retained Vijay Rupani as the CM of Gujarat. That is the latest information that we're getting to here on Mirror Now. Disha Shah joins us now with more details. Disha, Vijay Rupani there being retained as the CM?
एक ही प्रस्ताव है भारतीय जनता पार्टी गुजरात विधानसभा के विधायक दल के नेता के रूप में श्री विजय भाई रूपानी और उपनेता के रूप में श्री नितिन भाई पटेल का नाम लिया.
Well, that was Finance Minister Arun Jaitley there announcing that Vijay Rupani will be retained as the CM of Gujarat. We saw, of course, that the BJP was victorious in the state of Gujarat. Saffron surge in Gujarat, but now the BJP has decided to retain Vijay Rupani as the Chief Minister of Gujarat. Arun Jaitley, we heard just a while ago, announce that information, and that is the latest we're getting to you here on Mirror Now, where Vijay Rupani has been retained as the Chief Minister of Gujarat by the BJP. This after we saw saffron surge yet again back in the state of Gujarat. Vijay Rupani has been retained as the Chief Minister of Gujarat. Arun Jaitley, their Finance Minister, making that announcement a short while ago.
Thank you.
Yeah. In fact, we have Kajal joining us on the phone line. Kajal, Vijay Rupani, they're being retained as the Chief Minister of Gujarat. We also understand some latest information coming in. Nitin Patel has been named as the Deputy CM.
Yes, the BJP has decided to go with the same team of Vijay Rupani and Nitin Patel as CM and Deputy CM respectively. This has been decided in the meeting that was held in the Gandhinagar office of the BJP called Kamalam, and Arun Jaitley was also part of this meeting, and it has been decided to continue with both of them for a second term. And despite the speculations that were swirling around that Vijay Rupani might not be chosen once again, it seems that the BJP has decided that he is a safe bet for now.
All right, Kajal, many thanks for getting us those details there. Kajal Iyer getting us the latest information here on Mirror Now that Vijay Rupani has been retained as the CM of Gujarat. Nitin Patel there has been named as the Deputy CM. Moving on to some news coming in from Mumbai now. 10 days on and no arrests made so far in the Arpita Tiwari murder case. In fact, now we understand the family has made a request to the Chief Minister. They're taking the matter to the Chief Minister's office. They have also requested all five men to be questioned. We have Richa Sharma, who's been tracking the story continuously on Mirror Now, joining us with more details. Richa, no arrest made so far. It's been 10 days already.
That's right, Amita. It has been over 10 days now since the mysterious circumstances under which 24-year-old stage comparer Arpita Tiwari was found dead in the second floor duct after falling from the 15th floor of this high-rise building in the suburbs of Mumbai. And till now, the police would have only been questioning all the five men who were present at the spot, and none of them have been detained or arrested. We have been asking the police officials, and the family of the victim girl has also been asking the police officials regularly as to what is the progress in the case, but nothing has come out of so far. And because of this anger and frustration that the family is currently undergoing, they have now approached the CMO's office with a written letter where they have actually written down the sequence of the events as well as what the police version is, what their version is, and what are their demands. And the family is certainly demanding that this case should move forward in a fast track pace. The perpetrator should be arrested, and they are questioning that why is the police taking so much of time in gathering evidence of not just the post-mortem reports but also the forensic reports, which at this point are being awaited. So clearly this is the case we are closely tracking, and we will keep the eye. And next week the family will directly be going and talking to the CM, who is currently in the assembly session in Nagpur, and that's the reason the family couldn't meet him this week. And they have only submitted this letter which has been received from the CMO's office. So now we will keep a track to know what exactly the CM gives a response to this whole matter, and how soon will we be able to find out, because still there are no names that have been mentioned even in the FIR despite the police filing a murder case.
All right, Richard, they're getting us all the details. Despite several twists and turns we've seen in the Arpita Tiwari murder case, of course, now the family approaching the Chief Minister and demanding speedy investigation. We continue to track that story here on Mirror Now. On that note, we wrap things up on Pulse. We continue to get you the pulse of every city. Stay with us.